the 40th anniversary of the Farnborough Air Show, including Soviet military aircraft. That's next.
There's instant cash and instant trash. Deposit in the bin.
Never ever want another flat tire? You don't have to. This tire will run over a board of nails and won't puncture. The secret is Numaseal, and it works for all air-filled tires. Numaseal's proven formulation stops leaks and tread punctures for the life of the tire. It doesn't harm tires. With one simple application of Numaseal, you'll never risk another puncture, and that's guaranteed in writing. Prevent flat tires. Use guaranteed Numaseal.
Alan, why is it the night we come back you invite your parents for dinner?
Relax.
Hasn't she heard? Doesn't she know?
Alan, that was a shop.
Relax.
Hasn't she heard? Doesn't she know?
Alan, vegetables.
Hasn't she heard? Doesn't she know?
Alan,
I must change my
name. What's wrong with your car?
Relax.
Invite his parents to dinner. We need milk, ice cream, ground coffee, vegetables, his mother's biscuits, ice, coke, serviettes, a can opener, dishwashing, a good farm. I mean, you won't get them here, will you?
Relax. Relax. We've got dinner.
The way to go.
BP Super Shop. The next best thing to a supermarket. Just down the road.
Sunday at 20 to 8, the magnificent Evans replaces the mistress. Experience the Welsh wizardry of Ronnie Barker as Plantagenet Evans, an irrepressible cad with an eye for the ladies. The magnificent Evans, 20 to 8, Sunday on 1.
Welcome to Farnborough. This internationally acclaimed air show is a combination of sparkling air displays, static displays, and trade stands. Many tens of thousands of people have come here this year, and many multi-million pound deals have been done. Although there's a tremendous amount to see at Farnborough, there are some areas to which the public are not invited. For example, right here, where John Hutchison and Eric Steenson and I are now sitting. This is the inside of a Boeing 707, but a rather exclusive and opulent one. It's even got a bedroom. And right at the very back, there's a fully equipped bathroom. John, you used to fly 707s before Concorde and your current activities. Nothing like this, I assume.
I've never seen anything like this, fitted out to the most opulent standards. It's a sort of airborne royal train, I suppose. But the great thing is they've even thought of the pilots. They've given them the latest in avionics and luxurious furry seats to sit on.
And if Eric wanted to buy one, what's it going to cost him?
A mere $18 million, Eric.
Whew, a snip.
Have you got a highlight of Farnborough 88?
For me, it's got to be the MiG-29, and being able to compare it with the F-18 and the Rafale directly in the display. Tremendous.
Right. Well, we'll be seeing the MiG in just a moment, but we're going to start with the only display, which is a combination of fixed wing and rotary.
And what a breathtaking display it is, the aerial ballet of the Royal Navy. Display featuring six Sea Harriers, the Gazelles of the Sharks team, two Naval Lynx helicopters, and four variants of the highly successful Sea King. The Lynx, of course, is designed to operate from the backs of frigates in an anti-submarine role, and the Sea King is also deployed against submarines. This version is used by the Marines. And why is it these chaps always want to leave the helicopter before it's landed? Another Sea King in the display featured the searchwater radar, which folds down once the helicopter is airborne. And with a final nod to the crowd, the Sea Kings make way for the Harriers. Eric, have you ever experienced the flight performance of the Harrier?
Yes, fortunately, I had the opportunity, but only in the Air Force variety. Really, very few sights stop the business of Farnborough, but the Harrier is one that causes everyone's heads to turn. These Sea Harriers of 899 Squadron differ from the RAF ground attack version, as they're employed principally to defend the fleet against air attack. The impressive hover, of course, is an essential maneuver for the Harrier, so that it can stabilize alongside the moving ship before landing.
John, I believe the Harrier was the aircraft that really impressed the Russian visitors.
Well, it really impressed me too. As a spectacle of raw, dramatic power, this must surely be hard to beat. Those six Sea Harriers in the hover are producing a combined total thrust almost equal to that of Concorde.
The Gazelles of the Royal Navy Sharks. Gazelle is an extremely agile, single-turbine helicopter which actually is used by all three services for training. This unusual view is provided by our photographer, Lieutenant Dickie Bird. The Shark's pilots are training instructors at Royal Naval Air Station Caldrose in Cornwall. And in this very tight display, the pilots sometimes close to within half a rotor diameter. And finally, all the aircraft formate for a high-speed flypast. And once again, our thanks to the Navy for their help with our broadcasts from Farnborough.
And now for the RAF. Another showstopper, this time the Tornado. Designed for the long-range defense of our airspace, the Tornado, armed with air-to-air missiles, can accelerate quickly after takeoff, with its Rolls-Royce engines providing an initial rate of climb of up to 40,000 feet per minute. This acceleration enables it quickly to reach the combat area, where, with the wings swept forward, the F3 can loiter for long periods. But it's the advanced radar and weapons technology that enables the Tornado to perform autonomous all-weather air defense by day or night. It maneuvers well in combat with the wings swept forward, and for supersonic flight, they can sweep back automatically.
This engine is all about fuel efficiency and low noise levels at airports. The General Electric unducted fan. If the manufacturer's claims prove to be correct, it could soon be a familiar sight at airports around the world. I must say, I thought it was rather noisier during the takeoff run than I'd expected, but one has to remember that there's only one of those unducted fans mounted on this aircraft. The engine on the other side, on the right-hand side, is a conventional jet. So it's rather difficult to judge the noise levels.
John, it doesn't look very elegant though, does it? Those blades look extremely vicious.
Looks a bit like Boadicea's chariot blades, doesn't it?
Well, of course, as more and more aircraft enter service, the skies become increasingly crowded. John's been to see what the Civil Aviation Authority is doing in anticipation.
The airspace over southeast England is amongst the most crowded anywhere in the world, and the Civil Aviation Authority are responsible for providing the air traffic control for this airspace. They've come up with new proposals to help solve the problems of this congestion, and one of the air traffic controllers responsible for the introduction of these new proposals is Leslie Halloway.
Well, we're actually looking at a live radar display that is being fed from West Drayton, from the Pease Cottage radar, one of our new radars just south of Gatwick. There's Heathrow, Gatwick, four stacks for Heathrow, Bovingdon, Lambourne, Biggin and Ockham. As you can see, there's quite a lot of activity along the centre line of Heathrow's airfield. There's aircraft here inbound to Heathrow, British Midland aircraft 775, 5,300 feet now descending into Heathrow, and he's following a Danair 155 also into Heathrow, and they'll be putting shortly onto the extended centre line for lining up to Heathrow, being hotly pursued there by British Airways 733. Who again is being followed by another British Airways 409 coming in from the Clacton sector. So you can see now from all the aircraft that are tracking into this part of the sector here that Heathrow is going to be very, very busy. In fact, they are busy now dealing with this traffic. The area around Gatwick is also a very complex piece of airspace, very busy, a very high density of traffic.
Crowded skies like these over the southeast of England mean constant pressure on pilots and airports as well as air traffic controllers. The CAA's new proposals are intended to relieve some of this stress. In the present system, a controller is responsible for a particular bit of sky inside which many aircraft routes crisscross. In the new system, he'll simply concentrate on the whole of a particular route into or out of an airport and won't have to spend so much of his time talking to other controllers. To allow this to happen, the complex pattern of airways and stacking zones around the four major London airports will be reorganized. This model shows the new routings, which segregate conflicting movements and provide discrete airspace for inbound and outbound flights. There are other advantages as well.
The fact that the stacks are further out and higher up has economic advantages for the airlines and environmental advantages for people on the ground as well.
The CAA will start to make these changes in 1990, and the new system should be fully in use by the turn of the century.
I'm really lost for words of how to describe this takeoff. The parachute radar has been flown extensively by the British Army in the past 3 years. The Army is looking for a quiet, unobtrusive aircraft which will not stall or spin, which can be flown safely by soldiers with no flying experience after only 8 hours training. And there's also tremendous interest from the private market. The company had a very successful Farnborough, selling over 200 craft, which is pretty good going when you consider they cost approximately £6,500 each. Well, of course, tens of thousands of people came to see the Soviet aircraft, and clearly the Russians took their visit to Farnborough extremely seriously. It was therefore ironic that they suffered that engine problem which grounded the AN-124, which brought the support equipment for the MiGs. However, we were treated to an unscheduled visit from an Antonov 22 freighter that flew in a replacement engine. And it gave Western observers a rare chance to see the Antonov at close quarters. This aircraft first flew in 1965. There are now 55 in service. It's primarily a military aircraft, but some are also in service with Russia's Aeroflot. Well, back to the 124. It is by far the biggest aircraft ever to cast its shadow across the Hampshire countryside. John, how would you like to display this aircraft at an international air show?
Not sure that I would, actually. I don't think it goes fast enough for me. But an aspect of the display that did intrigue me was the 4-minute engine run that he did before takeoff. And it made me wonder if the engines are inclined to be a bit temperamental. Certainly, when one listened to the unvarying noise levels during his display, the pilot seemed to have the engine set at constant power. And that's confirmation, perhaps, that he was rather unwilling to change the power levels.
Eric, the thing that I noticed was that throughout the week, this display was conducted with the undercarriage down.
Well, certainly John's right, and the pilot is having to keep a high power setting. The drag from the wheels will help to keep the speed low, and And then with having the flaps down, it allows him to manoeuvre in a very tight space. The undercarriage itself is quite an interesting feature. Those 20 wheels in the main system are designed to be able to take the weight of the aircraft landing on ice and other unprepared surfaces. But it does present the sort of problem that he won't be able to cope with a crosswind in quite the same way as the more sophisticated undercarriage that the C5A Galaxy has, for example. Well, this quite magnificent aircraft presented a marvellous sight for the crowds inside Farnborough. And it did for a moment, as it made this low approach, stop the serious drinking that was going on at the Swan pub outside. A very impressive landing. But I suppose, Eric, the crowds really came to see the two meets. Well, their arrival was the highlight of the pre-show build-up. How about this for a rare sight? An air defence Tornado of number 5 squadron escorting a two-seat and a single-seat MiG-29 as they flew over southern England. This was the only chance we had to see the two flying together. And their impromptu display on arrival gave a hint of things to come. They even demonstrated their prowess at formation with this immaculate pair's landing. Glasnost even extended to a Russian pilot talking to a British navigator. And from that very dramatic takeoff, we're given a beautiful view of the integral design. It doesn't have separate fuselage and wings as such, yet it's flown with conventional control systems.
Eric, a thought that strikes me is that many people who've watched this very agile display must be wondering what's so special about the West's highly sophisticated fly-by-wire fighters.
Well, the MiG is being displayed by an experienced test pilot, whilst the pilots of the other fly-by-wire aircraft have life made much easier for them. The tail slide was the unique maneuver where the aircraft was literally flown to a standstill before being allowed to slide back for over 100 feet and then pitching forwards. And it's not a maneuver to be recommended, despite the pilot's comments.
That is not very difficult maneuver, not only for test pilot, but for any pilots.
Now, when you're flying, you fly a very tight, very precise display. How many G do you pull when you're going around those turns?
Approximately 9 G, mm-hmm. Plus minus. But we have no problem with G.
Good.
Due to very,
very strong
our construction.
Well, you've certainly provided the star attraction in this year's display. Everyone admires how precise your flying is. So on behalf of the public who are watching, may I thank you for the treat that you've given us at Farnborough in 1988.
Thank you. Thank you. Come on.
From Soviet aviation, we move down under. Aerospace Technologies of Australia has signed a joint venture with Brooklands Aircraft for an airborne surveillance system. The Optica Scout, well known to BBC viewers from previous Farnborough air shows, will carry equipment developed for use on Australia's Searchmaster aircraft. The project is to be marketed as the Scoutmaster. Astute viewers may think they recognise the pilot's profile. Flying the Optica Scout is veteran test pilot Neville Duke. He's been appearing at Farnborough since the early 1940s. He's perhaps best remembered for his sonic booms in the Hunter prototype.
I wonder how many of us ever think about what an aspiring aviator has to go through to become a qualified airline pilot. Well, for over a decade now, even the world's airlines haven't given too much thought to that problem, as they've met their limited needs from the ranks of the qualified service pilots or from that hardy breed of dedicated enthusiasts who've worked their own way through flying school. But now the situation has changed dramatically with a worldwide pilot shortage. And to meet this need, British Aerospace has opened this brand new, purpose-built flying college here at Prestwick.
Each course of 16 students start their flying training on craft such as this Piper Warrior, but the comprehensive 70 weeks of study begin not here, but back in the classroom.
Right, if you remember on straightforward recapping, we have done the frost...
The students, at present sponsored by British Airways, Cathay Pacific, and Gulf Air, run through all the basics of subjects such as aerodynamics and meteorology before progressing onto the more complex computer-based training aids.
Design of the Warrior aircraft began in June 1972. An important feature being the replacement of the earlier...
There are also cockpit simulators based directly on the craft the students are most likely to end up flying.
Air for the APU enters through a movable inlet door on the right side of the fuselage above the horizontal stabilizer.
This 757 simulator's voice guide takes the students step by step through its flight system. Row after row of shiny new trainers in this hangar reflect the £19 million investment required to set up this facility and indicates the urgency that large airlines like British Airways feel given the looming retirement of many of its senior captains. The course is designed to encourage teamwork, highlighting the fact that as computers take more of the actual flying off the captain, emphasis is put on flight management. Since the College of Air Training at Hamble closed in the late 70s, there has been no formal training for British airline pilots. So why is Prestwick the location for the new college?
It is an international airport, so we have real aeroplanes coming here, not trainers. And it has high ground around, so the students learn from day one that rocks kill and they stay away from them or above them. We actually do what we think is a totally unique course here. Obviously, we have to conform to the CAA's regulations in order that they achieve their pilot's license and instrument rating at the end. But in fact, our syllabus and everything we do here is geared to turn out an airline pilot. I'm not training Tornado pilots, Jaguar pilots. I'm training people who for the rest of their lives will operate with at least one other pilot on the flight deck of a very expensive piece of equipment.
What made you want to become a pilot?
I think it's really having lived near Heathrow Airport. I've always wanted to be one since my childhood, and seeing airliners fly over the house has intrigued me ever since.
It strikes me that this course is a pretty tough one. It lasts for 70 weeks, I believe. How are you finding it?
Well, there's quite a volume of work to get through, and I think the main thing to have to get through the course is enthusiasm, and without it, you'll be lost.
Now, how do you see your future as a pilot when you finish the course? When is that, by the way?
Well, we're aiming to finish the course by the end of February, the beginning of March. And with the current situation, with the shortage of pilots, I think we're in for quite a good thing, aiming to get onto long haul after about 3 years in the airline.
Well, I hope you enjoy flying as much as I've always enjoyed it.
Thank you.
Are they really, do you think, going to be capable of going straight into the right-hand seat of a 747 or 757, as you've
suggested? I think absolutely. I believe that if you train people, first of all, you've got to select them properly, and then having selected them and trained them properly, once they've got over that initial training 200 hours, you can then convert them onto anything at all, from a 747 down to a short 360. I believe it's the initial selection and training which is the most important part of the procedure of turning out airline pilots.
And this is one of the airplanes they will almost certainly fly, the Airbus A320. It looks quite ordinary, but that is actually highly deceptive. As test pilot Gordon Corr reminded me, it has 7 different computers to control the flying and the engine systems. Effectively, this means the aircraft knows its own limits, and that makes it safer. Industry's confidence in the A320 can be judged by the fact that there are orders and options for over 600 aircraft to 23 different customers.
Now here is a really exciting craft, the AH-64A Apache. Anti-armor helicopter, it's the free world's most advanced military helicopter, able to locate and strike targets at night and in adverse weather. The display is choreographed to emphasize the Apache's agility with 360-degree rolls, wing overs, and spiral descents. It really is a quite remarkable machine. The Apache navigates and finds targets with infrared sensors and destroys enemy armor with laser-guided missiles. And I still believe you shouldn't be able to do that maneuver in a helicopter. Excellent performance finishes off with the pilot turning the Apache and accelerating backwards to 45 knots. He then will start to climb, tail up to 300 feet before he accelerates away to the applause of the crowd.
This is the very latest in electronic flight instrumentation systems, EFIS for short, and it gives the modern professional pilot all the information he needs on just 2 television screens. This one is for helicopter use and made by Thomson CSF, and with me is John Hidalgo.
Good morning, John.
Good morning. Could you run through the information you're getting?
Of course. The pilot, which sits in the right, is in charge of the flight parameters of the aircraft. Here he has the altitude information in the vertical plane, okay. And we display his altitude scale, also his airspeed scale, and basically his vertical position with respect to the Earth. Also, the pilot uses a horizontal situation display to be aware of what his position is with respect to the beacons and the overall navigation. On this side, the co-pilot is in charge of the navigation. And we have developed a device which we call the digital map display, which is the one you're seeing here, which uses digital data derived from existing terrain. This is existing data which is available to all the defense agencies, and we reconstruct the terrain in real time to display to the co-pilot and possibly the pilot what the terrain in front of him looks like. This is most useful at night and during bad weather when he cannot look outside. Here, John, we have the two-dimensional mode which will move along with the aircraft and on which we can superimpose information about road, bridges, etc. and also display a collision avoidance mode, as you can see, in which the terrain above the flight altitude of the aircraft is displayed in red to warn the pilot. Here, John, is the three-dimensional mode, and we are flying along the northeastern region of France. As you can see, we have the terrain and also altitude information. And we can suppress all the data except for the altitude of the terrain. We also have the collision avoidance mode in three dimensions to warn the pilot. And we have generated a special mode for night application in which we display only the contour of the highest points in the terrain, again to bring the pilot some safety in his flight.
John, that really was most impressive. The only question I have to ask as a practicing pilot, would a pilot be justified in putting so much faith in terrain information generated by a computer?
I think no pilot, honestly, will trust 100% such an instrument, because first of all, he's risking his life. But you should think of this type of instrument as a backup and a workload reduction instrument, which means, for example, the navigation at night, which is today in today's helicopter is about 70% of the workload of the co-pilot, can be reduced to less than 10% with this kind of instrument, because it allows him to understand the terrain much faster and much better.
May I present the Red Arrows.
1988 has been a significant year for air displays, unfortunately for the wrong reasons, and even the Red Arrows have had their problems. It has been a difficult year, and it's a measure of the skill and determination of the team that they've been able to adapt so quickly to a seven aircraft display.
commentated on over 200 of the team's performances, and I'm still thrilled each time I see them. I think everyone's got so used to the precision and grace that they forget just how difficult it is. It's also been a joy to see the team against a blue sky for a change.
Well, we certainly look forward to seeing them back to full strength next year with 9 aircraft. And I wonder what the judges thought. Oh, look, there's always one, isn't there? It's the other way round. That's it.
Back to the combat aircraft and the McDonnell Douglas F-16. Spitfire. It's a short-range combat fighter flown by air forces around the world. The display is enhanced by smoke generators on the wingtips. They show the vortices generated by the difference in pressure above and below the wing as it generates lift. The more lift, the bigger the vortices. And that's best seen at high angles of attack. Graphic demonstration of the McDonnell Douglas F-16.
Farnborough is a good place to announce a new product, and it helps if you can get a politician along. That's why Robert Atkins, Under Secretary of State at the DTI, was here to publicise a new smoke hood, being developed with the help of government money. The idea is to protect passengers from the dangers of heat and smoke in an aircraft fire. Each passenger would have a smoke hood in a stowage on the back of the seat in front of him. Putting it on takes only a few seconds, and the hood buys valuable survival time while the aircraft is evacuated. In aeroplane accidents involving fire, more fatalities occur from smoke inhalation than from any other single cause.
And the visibility, yes.
Yes, I can see very well.
That's why there's a lobby that says smoke hoods like these are the answer. The critics insist that if smoke hoods are to be introduced, they must be fail-safe. The manufacturers claim that this smoke hood is fail-safe. You can only open the box and get it out if the hood's self-contained oxygen bottle is working properly. So, if you can get the hood out, say the manufacturers, it must be safe to use. And it's designed to give you 20 crucial minutes of survival time. The CAA and the airline industry must now decide whether this approach to safety is the right one.
Another aircraft taking part in each day's four-hour flying display was the Dassault Mirage 2000. Developed from the earlier 2000C air defense fighter, this is the two-seat strike version which came into service with the French Air Force in July this year. But as with many aircraft at the show, the manufacturers are looking for export orders of the multi-role derivative. Various types of this highly maneuverable Mirage are already flown in Greece, India, and a number of countries in the Middle East.
Despite the French aerospace industry holding the largest international air show in Paris every 2 years, they're faithful supporters of the SBAC show at Farnborough. Eurofar, Europe's answer to the American Bell Boeing V-22 tilt rotor, was shown by Aerospatiale, while Airbus emphasized the theme of international collaboration. Dassault Breger has moved on from the Mirage to the Rafale. Is this the shape of things to come, Eric?
Well, it's certainly looking that way. Dassault have always favoured Delta construction, and assisted by those forward canards, the Rafale is a natural development. That really is beautiful. The collaborative Eurofighter has adopted a similar design, and the Delta shape combines to satisfy the demands of high speed and manoeuvrability. We've been discussing power and drama, but for sheer looks, the Rafale certainly takes my first prize as the most elegant aircraft in the show.
One beautiful aircraft to another. Of course, international cooperation is typified by Concorde. The Anglo-French supersonic airliner has long been a crowd puller at airports and air shows all over the world. However, John, is it really true that this is our last opportunity to see Concorde at an air show?
Sadly, it does rather look as though this will be Concorde's last appearance at an air show, and she's certainly going to be very much missed. But the good news is that Concorde's carrying more passengers than ever. She's making a hefty contribution to British Airways profits, and the airframes are in such good nick that they're going to last for at least another 20 years. And for me, she's the most elegant aeroplane in the show.
Graceful shape passes above another as Captain John Cook brings Concorde in over the Swan Pub for a low pass. As well as providing a forum for the international aerospace industry to sell its products, Farnborough 88 provided huge entertainment for the tens of thousands who braved the terrible traffic. Congratulations to the police, who wisely did their best to relieve tensions and frustrations amongst the drivers. At times, the ground show was nearly as entertaining as the air show. Farnborough 1988. Goodbye.